Well, it's a good afternoon here. It's George Rocket, another DCD Talks. And today, my victim, well, not my victim, my interviewee is Jeanne Propst. She's the SVP of Data Center at Corning Optical Communications. How are you doing, Jeanne?
I'm doing fantastic. How are you doing? It's a pleasure for us to be here.
Yeah, no, I'm doing good. I'm in that DCD, it's pre-Thanksgiving, right? We have to get everything out of the door for 2022 before Thanksgiving because nobody will remember it after Thanksgiving.
After Thanksgiving.
So you're a Southern girl, but you're based where? You're not down south and you're not in Europe. Where are you?
I am actually in Corning, New York, but okay. Definitely I am a Southern girl.
You are a Southern girl. Corning is not the main hub of New York is not the main hub, is it? Or is it?
New York actually is the main hub for Corning Incorporated, absolutely. And we've been here our whole life, right, in Corning, New York, upstate New York, and it's such a beautiful place. But our division, of course, Corning Optical Communications, our main hub is actually in North Carolina.
Oh, yes. And I remember so many years ago reporting on the huge facility you built at the time. It had many zeros at the end, and it was like, you know, one of the most advanced research facilities. I remember that well. And you must too, because you are a career person at Corning.
Yes, a career.
Between, and some of the greats I've met are people that have been through it with a business and through its transformation. So, 1991, what were you doing in 1991 at Corning?
Actually, yes, I can hardly believe that this is my 30th year at Corning. Actually, this is my 30th year this year. I can actually hardly believe it. But my very first job at Corning is something extremely applicable, as we'll talk to today, which was making cable assemblies in the factory. So I made cable assemblies that we sell to the data center still today. So that was my first job at Corning.
Wow, that's amazing. So you really do have a grasp from the factory line all the way into the customer.
Yes, that is, and probably through those 30 years, in some form or fashion, I have actually been associated with the data center market, whether it was marketing, market development, product management, or product development. My whole career actually has been somehow tied. We called it enterprise back in the day, but somehow tied to the data center market.
What did it look like? When did you first come across the data center? And kind of like, you know, what did it look like to you, this sector at that time?
Yeah, you know, years ago, we didn't even call it data center, right? We weren't even that sophisticated that we called it the data center market. We actually called it the enterprise market. And, you know, it could be a mix of customers building LAN networks or doing interbuilding networks. And then, you know, sometimes they had a data center somewhere, maybe in the basement, that looked like, you know, a rack, for example. So it's just a very different market than certainly it is today, right?
What an amazing, I think, so you've had a personal journey, and I kind of, there's a bit of trivia. Corning made the glass for the first light bulb, right?
Yes, Corning has a history of innovation, right? We're 170 years old. We've spent our entire life actually working with our customers to solve their problems. Started back with the glass bulb for Thomas Edison.
Wow, amazing. It's funny how, like, what goes around comes around again. It started off with energy and glass. And basically today, I think we're going to talk later on about the symbiosis of energy and glass. Yeah. Right? So give me a bit of a history, because I mean, some people will be listening. They kind of like, they get the world of fiber optics, but where does that sit in the whole data center story? I mean, we talk about data centers and how data centers are built, right? Mm-hmm. But then data centers are connected, and now they're more connected inside sometimes and outside. Mm-hmm. What's the world that we're talking about here?
Yeah, the data center world, and as in the relation to fiber, right? So in 1970, Corning actually invented the world's first low-loss fiber. And I think that built the telecommunications market that we know today, right? That's the foundation of the telecommunications market. And that actually, I think, that has led to the data centers that we know today, right? The deployment of fiber, being able to deploy fiber much more easily, being able to deploy it, you know, in a reasonable cost position. And then really building upon the fiber was all the connectivity, right? So that really connectivity has really built the data center market that we know today. So it's all really about that evolution of glass and the way we, you know, the way we took glass into fiber optics and then really into the data center market that we know today. Most data centers today run off of fiber optic cable.
Right. And what you said there, like low loss at the beginning, right? So loss has been an issue. And I remember you said you were working at the assembly line at the beginning, making the connections that sorted out that loss. What's the connection with loss first?
Yeah, so you have to have in order for a system to be workable, right, or a system to operate in the best way, you really have to have a manageable loss. You can't have a system that has a lot of loss, right? So, and you know, the more light that gets through, the more light that you know, the less loss. And so when we first built the system, of course you had a lot of loss because we just didn't know what we know today, right? And so once you had a fiber, then you started to get actives and equipment that could actually run over the fiber. So the loss is really important for a data center, right? You've got multiple connections inside a data center, so loss is really important. And that loss has significantly improved over the years with advancements in fiber and advancements in the active gear as well.
Okay, that's interesting. What I want to kind of like get to, because I really don't know the subject here, so it's painting a picture. We've kind of like, we've innovated pieces of glass that send light down them, right? Mm-hmm. And that's what, so a 50-year-old innovation.
Mm-hmm. 50-year-old innovation.
And then over that time, we were an enterprise data center. Now it's become a data center, and funnily mm-hmm. enough, it's now kind of like spoked off into different types of data mm-hmm. centers. How do you talk in your sector and with your clients about the quantity of install base? Is it about the meters that are laid down, the number of connection points, the number of wavelengths? What do you guys talk about? Because generally we talk megawatts, right, when we're building data yeah. centers. Mm-hmm. Is there an equivalency in the connective power of that facility?
Yeah, sometimes we talk certainly megawatts, right, about the size, right, the size of the data center, right, we'll often talk megawatts, but we talk in kilometers, right, how much cable kilometers, right, kilometers. We talk about volume of ports, right, we talk about port density or a number of servers or number of connections inside the data center. That's kind of how we speak about the data center, whether it's fiber kilometers, number of ports, number of servers, number of data halls, even we talk. So those are the kinds of ways we talk about the data center.
Okay, so now we're armed with that. We're in this age of hyperscalers. We've got colos working for hyperscalers. We've got enterprises with their, you know, starting to use supercomputers. We're talking about the age of AI. There probably isn't a typical one, but can you talk a bit about the scale of the operation today and how that scaled over the last decade? Because I know hyperscalers are big, they're big business for you. Mm-hmm. We can't talk about them specifically, right?
Yeah. But
top of the tree, what does an engagement look like when somebody engages a company like Corning? What are they looking for? What are the challenges that they're looking to overcome by, you know, partnering with a Corning?
Yeah. So definitely the scale of data centers has changed significantly, right, over the years, especially with the hyperscales, right, and building, you know, just the data center campuses have changed. Traditionally, you know, in the past, you would be talking about a single data center, a single building as a data center. And now with the hyperscales, you know, you're talking about the hyperscales build a campus. Traditionally, a hyperscale could have, or typically a traditional hyperscale could have three buildings or five data center buildings on a campus. So you're not really talking about a single location anymore. You're talking about multiple buildings into kind of a campus location. And that's really how the hyperscales have changed, really how the data center looks. You're talking about big campuses in the past, you would be talking about a land, right, with a lot of campuses on it, maybe like a university with multiple campuses that people are trying to connect. And so that's how the hyperscales have really changed the face of the data center market. And, you know, they have a lot of different challenges in that, you know, in that scenario where you've got 3 to 5 buildings that you're trying to connect. That can mean that the hyperscale operators are trying to connect volumes and volumes of fiber. So it could be 50,000, 60,000 fibers that they're trying to connect. And when they talk to us, they want to know how to solve the challenges that they're having with deployment. And, you know, even in a normal situation, in a normal market, the challenges you face trying to connect that volume of fibers is it takes multiple weeks and weeks and weeks to do all the cable prep required and all the splicing required to connect that kind of volume of fibers and that many buildings together. So when they're talking to us, they're talking about how can they reduce the speed of deployment? How can they mitigate some of the labor challenges that they have? You know, labor challenges we see all over the industry today, whether it's your restaurant workers, whether it's your grocery store workers, we're seeing lots of labor challenges across the industry. And, you know, for a hyperscale, their labor challenges could be, it could be the volume of labor that they need. It could be this particular skill set of labor they need. And often it could be location of labor. So maybe the data centers are not in the exact location where the labor also lives. So they often talk to us about how do they solve their labor challenges and how do they solve their speed of deployment challenges, right? Because for a hyperscale, that speed of deployment is time to revenue or speed to market. And so it's important that they get their data center connected up and running as quickly as they can. And, you know, the little secret in a fiber optic system is that it's really quite simple. You are always connecting point A to point B, always. And the absolute fastest way to connect point A to point B is to use something that's pre-terminated. So the hyperscales are talking to us about speed of deployment. And actually also in this scenario, in this campus scenario where they're connecting multiple buildings, they're also talking to us about pathway. How do they utilize their pathway properly? How can they put in less pathway, right? So how do they utilize their duct space? How do they get good return on investment to their pathway? So generally those are the kinds of problems or challenges they're talking to us about how can they solve.
Okay, it's really interesting. I'm kind of like asking, like, they're not dumb questions, but I'm actually really building a picture because it's. I was speaking with an electrical subcontractor, I don't know, in the summer, and they were talking about, you know, some of the barriers to deployment is just the copper termination, right? So you're in a data center, you've got 5,000 terminations of this of copper that's delivering electricity, so there's a life safety issue, and it's just the sheer volume of it and scale of it is enormous. But you're talking about much more than 5,000 terminations, I'm imagining, in a typical data center, and splice, you know, so in the old world somebody would be splicing each of those, putting the connection, putting it in, but now you're talking about way more. How many type terminations could there be on a campus?
It certainly, it depends on the number of buildings, certainly, but, you know, you could, you know, in the what happened over the years is data centers got larger and larger, and whether you're in a campus or not, you started to see, you know, core switches with hundreds of ports, right? You started to see core switches with hundreds of ports. And so that really makes for thousands and thousands and tens of thousands of terminations inside a data center now. And in this campus environment, you could see as many as 50,000 terminations, because you're not talking about connecting a 288 cable or an 864 cable. Now you're talking about connecting those buildings with a 3456 cable. And even in some instances, maybe larger than that. So you're talking about 50,000 or so terminations. And you know, what you said is really important. If you go back to go back in the past, all those terminations used to have to be terminated in the field, hand polishing. That's what I did in the factory. Hand polishing those connectors, cable prepping that cable, and even splicing. And so that's a real challenge for the data centers, is how can they connect that volume of fibers in 2 weeks versus 6 weeks, or in, you know, as little as 2 weeks versus multiple weeks. So that's actually really a problem for the data centers today.
And so this pre-terminated type technology, I mean, what's yours? I can't remember the name off the top of my head.
Yeah, in the mid-90s, we introduced a pre-terminated solution called Plug and Play.
Okay. And what's that today?
And so we introduced that in the mid-90s, Plug and Play. And that actually was the first pre-terminated solution for the industry. And that is simply, we take a trunk cable, we put on an MTP connector, we do that in the factory. And that gave operators the ability to install a data center cabling and as much as 70% faster than the traditional splicing methods. And so that actually revolutionized the way the operators thought about deploying the physical layer. And we've been building on that plug and play platform since the mid 90s. And, you know, today's platform, we call it Edge Rapid Connect. It is the new pathway to extreme density. And it still gives you the same ability, the factory quality inside a field install, as well as it can be installed 70% faster than your traditional environments.
That's a huge amount of efficiency, right? I can see why hyperscale companies and their colos and everybody else wants that in this day and age. Really, really, thanks for walking me through that. I don't want to get like stuck into the technology because I like, you know, I've seen, we've got scale, we've got solutions. I'm just thinking, actually, there's a guy used to work, maybe he still doesn't call him, Tony Robinson.
Yes.
Tony. And I remember seeing a presentation once, and it was about a campus. This was maybe a couple of years ago. And he said that the connection between the buildings could have as much fiber as going under a cable in the transatlantic cable.
Yeah.
Such was the, it's all pulling back now. You've woken the cabling beast inside of me. So what other challenges? So we've talked about the throughput, density increasing of network traffic, and you've got solutions for that. What else? So sustainability is huge on the agenda. And you know, I'm imagining at Corning, you know, you're a big stock listed company, you're bound by, you know, all of these, you know, this forward thinking agenda on sustainability. There's Scope 3, I guess people are, you know, starting to ask about, you know, what's the carbon embodiment of what's going on? What's the Corning story on sustainability? Where are you pitching it and what are you doing to help clients with that overall story?
Yeah, so at Corning, you know, we care about a couple things, right? We certainly care about the what, right? Our job is to be sure that we are creating life-changing innovation that impacts people's life in a positive way. So we definitely care about the what, but we also care about the how, right? So we've been around for 170 years. We want to be around for another 170 years. So we want to make the world a better place. And we want to make the world a better place today, but we also want to make the world a better place for future generations. So we care about the what and we care about the how. So our job when it comes to product portfolio is to make sure that we are designing and manufacturing products that are more environmentally friendly than the products that you have today. And we're doing that really, in terms of raw materials as well as in terms of packaging. We think that we can actually develop products that are more sustainable and can contribute to the customer's publicly stated, you know, sustainability goals. And we think we can develop solutions in the future that can actually reduce the carbon footprint by as much as 50% compared to the products that are installed today. So we're super excited about sustainability. We care about the how as much as we care about the what. And our job is to make sure that we're designing all the way from concept to design to the selection of raw materials, the sourcing of raw materials, the manufacturing, the customer use, and even to the end of life of that product and making sure that it is more environmentally friendly than it is today. And we think that if we can do that, you know, do that in that way, we really help our customers, you know, meet their sustainability goals as well.
It's really interesting. It's not a curveball, but it's a question, you know.
Yeah.
What's the life cycle today of an install network? So we hear about data centers, you know, the life's 15 years. We said that for so long, right, in the beginning. It actually seems it's longer than that, right? I'm looking at, I saw a news story about the data center changing hands this week. I thought, wow, somebody's still buying that. And I remember that being built in 1997 or something.
Yeah.
So they've got long arcs, which is great. Mm-hmm. What's that life cycle of the network? Because, I mean, I'm hearing less and less now about the jumps of how much bandwidth you can get through the cable. Densities working in other ways. Do we have a longer life cycle today, or is it getting shorter of that?
I think it depends on the data center, right? You know, traditionally we would say probably 25 years. You know, that would be something traditionally we would say. But I think it depends on the, who's building the data center, right? You know, some of the hyperscales, their data centers don't have that. The data center has a long life cycle, but their cable plans, you know, reiterate, right? And the architecture changes or the topology changes. So really it really depends, I think, on the data center, kind of their growth plans, what the data center's trying to do, right? The content they're trying to generate or the bandwidth that they need. So I think it depends on the data center really for the life cycle question.
Okay, interesting. I imagine with the advances in pre-termination and things like that, it's probably much easier to do a live update, right?
Oh yeah, exactly. You can, you know, with a pre-terminated cable, the pre-terminated cable, you can be in your current data center and put in a new link, or you can be in your current data center and replace a link extremely easy and extremely quickly. And one thing that you mentioned earlier, I think, is really important that the data centers also care about is safety, but they want to be able to do the work safely. You can do a pre-terminated without needing, you know, sharp tools on site, without having to do any of that cable prep. And also pre-terminated lets you get the people on site data center and let you do the work quickly. So they get on site and they get off site very quickly. So a pre-terminated system also, you know, allows itself, has a huge safety factor in it as well.
Wonderful. Okay, it's interesting. So now diving around or moving around a little bit, we've never seen data centers as big as are being built today, and that's affecting every part of the market. Colos, hyperscales building their own data centers. We've had this shock of COVID, and it's still in the news today, every day, about disruption to supply chain, especially you know, anything with a chip in it at the moment, whether it's a car or a server or anything.
Yes.
How's that impacting in your world, in the glass world? You know, have you had a disruption, or have you been able, you know, because of what you do, what's the disruption story going on?
Well, I think it's two things, really. You have really two big impactful things happening in the market at the same time. And I don't remember a time where we've had both of these challenges at the same time. So one, you have really the network infrastructure investment has accelerated. And that is causing, you know, the capacity in the industry to be challenged. You know, the demand for the Corning portfolio has significantly increased as we're coming out of COVID. People want to build and they're ready to build. And so the demand for our product has really changed. So you've got network investment that is accelerating globally. At the same time, you have raw material challenges and transportation challenges that are really disrupting the supply chains. So you've got two big impactful events happening at the same time that are creating a lot of challenges in the industry.
Okay.
One thing for Corning, we've actually had and we're addressing both of these challenges proactively. One, we have been building capacity, and we are continuing to build capacity to make sure that we can take care of our customers' needs and their demand. So that's one. The second thing is we've been able to utilize our global supply chain to really mitigate the supply disruptions that we've seen. As you would expect, we've built a global supply chain over the years to ensure that we remain able to supply and we can mitigate any disruptions that we see. So we're leveraging that to mitigate whether it's raw material disruptions. We also use our global manufacturing to make sure that we are manufacturing as close to the customer as we can. That helps mitigate, you know, supply challenges or transportation challenges. And then we're actually fortunate that we have a network of distribution partners, and we are working with those guys to make sure that we have the right inventory at the right place at the right time to also mitigate any of the challenges that we have. So, you know, between our capacity and our supply, our global supply chain and our distribution network, I think we may be able to mitigate those challenges a little bit differently maybe than some other companies can. But it has definitely been a challenging situation in this past year for sure.
You are not alone. You are not alone. It comes up in every kind of like conversation. So got 170 years of innovation. We've got a booming industry that's a life support for the world as we know it at the moment, right? There's going to be more things connected in more places. We hear
more things.
Billions of devices in different ways, and we're going to hope. I'm waiting to be connected by optical cable in my street, actually. So it's not just a data center. It's the consumer world, the domestic world as well.
That fiber to the home is definitely coming.
Yeah, no, they've dug up my street. They sent the letter through. They just haven't popped the building yet. But what can we expect in the future? You've got this really big science and technology team where you are in New York. We've got an explosive industry. 5G, it feels like it was put on the back burner a little bit over COVID. All these things are coming back. Where's the next stage of innovation that your team's working on that you can talk about generally, right, that's going to impact the data center industry?
Yeah, so you're right. We definitely like to keep our science and technology team extremely busy. And actually, they love it. They would have it no other way. So there are a couple technologies that we are watching and a couple technologies we're investing in to make sure that as the data center evolves, our portfolio evolves. But, you know, first you mentioned is 5G. We think 5G, you know, it's getting a lot of attention now. 5G is actually going to, we're actually watching how 5G will drive low latency applications closer to the edge, right? We're working and watching to see what data customers will manage from the edge of the network and where those edge networks will be built. And we want to make sure that we're watching that so that we can understand how best for us to add value at the edge data centers. But that is something really happening in our industry today. Most people are talking about how to do more at the edge. So I think that's a huge next technology that's certainly going to happen in the data center. The next one we're watching is, as you mentioned earlier, is high performance computing. We're watching this in terms of artificial intelligence and in terms of machine learning. We are watching to see, and what we think from high performance computing is you possibly will need new cooling technologies within the data center. So we have to understand what our portfolio has to look like to interact with those new cooling technologies. And we also think that you might need really more machine-to-machine connections inside the data center, right? We call that back-end connections. So maybe more devices inside the data center need to be connected. And we're watching to understand what kind of scalability or how that might drive the next generation of density inside the data center. So those are two kind of big things that we're watching. But one thing that we know for sure is that the data center of 2025 will definitely not look like the data center of today. And our job is to make sure that we're watching those technologies, investing in those technologies so that our portfolio evolves really as the data centers evolve.
Jeanne, you're there as the SVP of the data center at Corny. You've got a global kind of like remit. There's lots on your plate. It's been a blast speaking to you because clearly you know the subject inside out. I hope I didn't ask two dumb questions at the beginning, but I know there's going to be a few people listening going, okay, I get it. So I get it. Thank you for helping me.
Yes, no, it's a real pleasure. Of course, we love to talk about everything data center and everything fiber optic. That is our life, and we definitely love to talk about it.
Well, hopefully we'll be catching up. Maybe next year we'll be in DCD New York for its 20th anniversary in April. Maybe that'll give us an opportunity to catch up in person, if not before. But thank you so much
for having us. It was a pleasure, and we look forward to talking to you soon.